Very warm welcome to you, Professor.
Thank you very much.
Well, let's just start with this issue, rural development in South Africa. We've seen the progress seems to have been quite slow. How can transport play a role in that?
I think there's some very pertinent examples that you can take. If I start off with a very simple one, we know unemployment is very high in the country. I know a young entrepreneur, he's manufacturing welding bicycle stands. He's living in Gauteng, gets an order from Cape Town, puts it on the transport system tomorrow morning, and by what's that Saturday, the guy in Cape Town has got his stuff for 50 to 100 rand transport cost. Good business. If that guy lived in Seshego in Limpopo or in Alice in the Eastern Cape, probably four times the transport cost.
And Alice is much closer to Cape Town.
Still closer, but sorry, there's not a good transportation system. So transport cost three to four times. The guy in Cape Town says, sorry, it's too expensive, mm-hmm. I don't want it. That's a small entrepreneur. You've got a big businessman sitting here in Joburg, and I get a call now from a client in Durban, Cape Town, or London. If I really put some effort into it, I can be at that meeting tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock. Again, if I'm the businessman in Alice and Seshego, I tell them, sorry, I think I can be there by sometime next week. I lose the business. Mm-hmm. Last good example, I mean, we've got the SKA that's been awarded to South Africa recently. We think, wow, it's good science, and it is. We need to get the infrastructure constructed. We need to get the foreign scientists to Carnarvon in the Karoo. If we don't have the transport system, we cannot get there. So if we don't look at the rural areas, look at the transport systems and the quality, it cannot happen. Mm. If you're a farmer in Limpopo, you produce fruit and vegetables, you have to get it to the market. We are currently running some tests and measurements where we look at the effect of bad road conditions and the inadequacy of your product when it lands in the market and there's damage to the product. And the guy that buys it at the market says, doesn't look so, good, I don't want to pay for it.
Impacting your competitive advantage.
Exactly. There. And again, that means that the guy that tries to develop the rural area, he doesn't get the income, he can't pay his laborers, his tax is less. So less tax into the government.
And also, why do you want to invest if it's going to cost you so much? Why do you want to then stay in Limpopo
exactly.
or in Alice if you can come to Gauteng?
Exactly.
And so that then we start talking about migration, I would imagine.
And then everybody moves to Gauteng and the roads become busy again and we can't move again and we've got congestion. We need people in the rural areas to run their businesses there, to be active there, because it's part of the country, it's important, you need that. But then they need to be accessible to markets for the country to grow.
So how much are we doing? Because our producer for the program was saying to me before that they had a discussion when we were organizing this interview earlier on today, and they were saying that if you look at transport, for instance, it seems as though, and this is from people that might be observing from the outside in, that it seems as though there doesn't seem to be as much focus when it comes to transport. Yes, we talk about infrastructure development and all this money that's going into that, but in terms of political will, how serious is that portfolio of transport in the country taken? What is your view on that?
My perception is that government has started to appreciate the importance much more in the last number of years. Unfortunately, it's not something that you decide on today and tomorrow you fix it, because it costs a lot of money and because you have to prioritize. For instance, going back to our two examples, am I going to maintain and upgrade the road to Alice or the one to Seshego first? I need to look, what's the market, what's the potential, how much money do I have available? What was quite important and coming through from the conference earlier this week, the Minister of Transport is a patron of the conference, so he delivered the opening address. We had some plenary speakers from the Netherlands, from the USA, and all of them came and they told us, listen guys, if you want to get it to work, get everything integrated. If you want to build that new road to this rural area, make sure that you do not only plan the new road and the construction, but plan how to maintain it, when are you going to maintain it, what are you going to do if business is growing and suddenly you've got a lot of trucks on that road. You need to plan everything in an integrated way. We cannot have one section which was doing the construction planning and they say, well, new road, there we go, and you guys there in the other department must think about the maintenance later on. Because maintenance is one of the major issues that we sit with in transport in South Africa. We need to plan it. It's normal. You don't maintain something because it's broken. You maintain something because it's part of normal life.
So what I'd like to talk about, I mean, from a business perspective, it's like you say, you have have to look at your return on investment, which one at this time is probably more urgent. But if we look at a government's commitment to rural development, if we also look at government's commitment to poverty eradication in the country, how much more urgent does it become then if we look at it from that point of view?
I think it's absolutely one of the primary issues that needs attention. Because as we said earlier, our choice is all those people need to move to the market opportunities, which is currently in the cities, or we need to develop the market opportunities for them. And that's the only way to do it. And if you want to look at it at a bit of a more economic viewpoint, the benefit for government is a higher GDP. If you look at government as a business, higher GDP, that's good. How are you going to get a higher GDP? You are going to grow the businesses in all areas, because if that farmer with the vegetables can have a better income, his profit goes up, he can pay his laborers more, they've got a better income, and he needs to pay more tax because his profit is higher. Through that process, the GDP grows, and it's a benefit to government.
But doesn't it also, I mean, I would imagine it's not just, you know, business that's wanting to get to, even though that is important, but even for the people that are living there. I know a friend of mine just had a project near Alice in the Eastern Cape right now, and just for them to get to where they were going, I mean, their cars broke down, and then that was such an issue to just go to the school that they were going to for the project that they were doing. So just in terms of that, and how much, you know, if you are in there as an entrepreneur, or if you're a person that wants to get around, it just becomes that much more difficult, and then you don't really want to do the projects that might actually uplift those areas.
Exactly. It's more difficult and it's more costly. If you want to go to school and it's going to take you 5 hours to get to school, I can't blame you if you say, I'm not going to go to school. If you want to take your baby to a clinic and it's going to take you a day to get to the clinic, you look at it and you say, listen, it's just not possible for me. So what happens? Health goes down. So I think for a normal person sitting in one of those areas, the difference that it makes if they can travel is just so much better. Very often we look at it from Gauteng and we say, wow, it's so romantic. I needed to travel for 5 hours with a 4x4 to get this place. It's so secluded. It's wonderful. What you don't think about is that the poor people living there also needs to travel for 5 hours to go and buy a bread.
It's not romantic for them.
It's not romantic. It's like snow. Snow is romantic if you stay in a hotel and somebody else is cleaning it up. If it's around your house and it becomes slush, it's not romantic anymore. So it's that type of idea that we need to think about and say, but how can we change life for that person? Because it's easy to blame them and say, but you guys are not doing anything. You don't start businesses. You don't sell your fruit. What's your problem? Your problem may just be that you don't have a road.
So the private sector, how do they come on board with something like this? Because I think one of the things that we do a lot in South Africa is we always talk about government's role. Yeah. So I would imagine that private sector might have a role to play in this. What would it be if it did?
I think in the first place, what private sector needs to do is to hand in hand with government, because it will always, you need both parts of that, is to identify the potential for those businesses, identify the potential for those economic developments, and then come to government and indicate, not if you do something, we will do something, but listen guys, we've got this plan, we've got this factory, we've got this community farm or whatever, this is our part that we would like to invest. And then we must always remember that a major part of what private sector and business is doing is they pay tax. Mm-hmm. And the moment we get private sector to be profitable, tax income goes up. So it remains a beneficial circle if we look at it from that way. So it's bad from a transportation system if we look at a cost-benefit issue and we say, but the cost is for government because I have to supply and maintain the road, and the benefit is for the private sector. It's not like that. Mm-hmm. If you go one step higher, yes, the benefit is for private sector. They get a higher profit, but they pay more tax. The tax goes back to government. So you need to look at it together.
I want to go back to the issue that you raised about integrated, where we're talking about construction, maintenance, and all of that coming together. Just in terms of the projects that we have had so far, even in urban areas, how well are we doing in terms of integrated transport development?
I think, in general, we battle. We get it right in some cases. To give you an example, integrated transport. I traveled from Pretoria here this afternoon, so I decided I'm not in the mood to be in my car again. So I got to the Gautrain, hopped on the train, got here, got the bus over here, and it's working, which is wonderful. My problem is if I go back tonight, there's not a bus to my home, so that part of the integration is not working. But we are getting closer. Depending on where we are sitting in the system, it becomes possible to have an integrated system where you don't have to think, okay, the train will be okay up until that point, but there's a gap and I don't know how am I going to fill that gap.
One of the things that I see, and I want to ask you this quickly, one of the things that I have seen with the Gautrain when I just hear of the experiences that people have is I think it's been such a fantastic learning curve for South Africa, because it's only when you have something in place that you can see where the gaps are and that you can fix it.
Exactly. If you don't have people sitting on the train and traveling on the train and starting to say, listen, I want a more regular service because suddenly I want to travel over a weekend to Sandton, which I didn't do before because the opportunity wasn't there, you will never get there. It's nice to have the models. It's nice to say, wow, if we add this and we add that, something will happen. But it's only when you start to do it. And unfortunately, as with anything that you do, there will be bumps on your head. Mm. You will do something, and I think yesterday afternoon there was an hour or so that the train stood still at some problem. It's going to happen. It happens all over the world. You sit in the tube in London, you sit in the BART in San Francisco, something goes wrong and the train stops. It's not the end of the world. It happens. Look at all the time that the train is actually running on time. You look at your smartphone and it says it will be here in 4.5 minutes. 4.5 minutes later, the train is there. It's working. We can make it work. Mm-hmm. And I think very often we are so negative. We say, listen, here in Africa, we've got potholes. The taxis drive like they want to. People are not that clever. We don't know what to do. We should look at the positive things. We export skills, not because they don't want to be here, but because the rest of the world want these people. We've got good systems. We can improve them. We can use the infrastructure that we've got and just get it running. So good for us.
Thank you so much for coming, Professor Steyn.
It's a real pleasure.
That was Professor Wynand Steyn from the Civil Engineering Department at the University of Pretoria, and he was talking rural infrastructure development and transport for integrated economic growth.